In this tutorial, we will take a look at object-oriented programming, and more specifically, how we can create classes and use inheritance in Lua. Object-oriented programming is a very popular paradigm, and while Lua technically does not have classes, we can emulate its behavior. So what is a class and what are the benefits of using them? Imagine that you want to create several enemies for your game. You could create multiple tables, each with their own values and functions. This would, however, turn into a nightmare very quickly. The idea of object-oriented programming, or OOP for short, is that you make a single class, which you then create multiple instances of. To continue with the previous example, we would create an enemy class, and then use that class as a blueprint to create multiple enemy instances. Let's have a look at how to do it with code. We start by creating a table named Animal. Then create another table, which I will name MetaAnimal. This meta table will have an index, which we add by typing dot underscore underscore index, and set to be equal to animal. This index basically tells the program where to look for a specific function or variable if it failed to find it in its own table. This means that we can assign the MetaAnimal table to any other table, allowing it to access the animal table. You could say that we now have a class named Animal. In order for us to be able to create instances of this class, we need to create a function which handles that. I will name it animal.new. For those of you with experience from other programming languages such as Java or C#, this will act as the constructor. The reason I use a period instead of a colon is to make it clear that this is not a function which instances are supposed to use. In other programming languages, it would be called a static function. This function will take one argument, the name of the animal. We then create a local table, which I will name instance. But instead of setting it to be equal to curly brackets, we will use the Lua function setMetaTable. It takes two arguments. First, the table which should be able to access the parent table, and then the MetaTable which contains the index to the parent table. In this case, we just want a new empty table, and then we pass in the MetaAnimal table. Now we can move on as normal and initiate some variables. I will create a name variable, which gets assigned to the name argument. When we are done, we simply return the instance table. Let's create a function for the class which can be used by the instances. I will name it displayName. Since this function is supposed to be used by each instance, I use a colon, which allows us to use the self keyword. Inside, we will simply print the name of the animal. To test this out, I will create a few instances by assigning the animal.new function to a new variable. I can then call displayName on them in order to make each of them print out their own name. There is a way to do this which, in my opinion, is slightly cleaner. We can have the animal table be its own meta table with an index pointing towards itself. We do that by removing the MetaAnimal, and instead setting the index variable of the animal to point to itself. We can now set the meta table of the instance directly to the animal table. Both of these methods accomplish the same thing. I just think it's easier to grasp the concept when the meta table is its own separate table. With classes, we were able to avoid code repetition by reusing functions for each instance. Another common concept in object-oriented programming is that of inheritance. Similarly, it allows us to reuse and shorten our code. Let's return to the enemy in a game example. Imagine that your game has a lot of different enemies. They all share a lot of functionality, but have some unique behaviors or abilities. Some might be flying while others walk, and some might use melee attacks while others use ranged abilities. If we were to keep creating new classes for each of these enemies, we would have to repeat a lot of code due to the fact that they still have a lot of shared functionality. For example, all enemies can take damage and move around. We can create an abstract enemy class, which contains the common functionality, which all enemies share. We can then inherit this enemy base class to each of our specific enemies. Let's return to the animal class code, and turn it into an abstract base class. All we really need to do in order to make it abstract is to ensure that we cannot create instances of it. So we remove the constructor function. Next, we can create another abstract class, fish, which will inherit the animal class. This will look very similar at first. We create a new table named fish and set its index to point to itself. In order to make the fish class inherit the animal class, we simply set its metatable to be the animal by calling setMetatable and passing in fish and animal. Now we will create a class which will inherit from the fish and subsequently also the animal. I will create a new table named red herring. Just like with the fish class, I will set its index to point to itself and then call setMetatable, passing in red herring and fish. We want to be able to instantiate this class, so I will create a constructor for it, just like we did for the animal class before. Now we can test if this works by creating an instance of the red herring class. I can now call displayName on it. And if we run the program, you can see that it is able to print its own name. The way that it works is that the red herring instance will first check the red herring table for a function named displayName. When it does not find it, it will check its metatable, the fish. Once it fails to find it there, it continues to the metatable of the fish, which is the animal, where it finally finds and uses the function. Understanding this chain is important, because it allows us to overshadow functions. In other words, we can inherit a class and cherry-pick which functions we want to modify. If we, for example, add a slightly modified version of the displayName function to the fish class, it will overshadow the function in the animal class. When we run the program, you can see that it indeed uses the function in the fish class. It will always use the function which is closest in the inheritance tree. Similarly, if we add a displayName function to the red herring class and modify it slightly, you can see that it now uses this function instead of the fish version. That is it for this tutorial. If you made it this far, leave a like and subscribe so you don't miss any future content. And as always, if you have any questions, let me know in the comment section down below and I'll answer them as soon as possible.